Well, what a wonderful way to begin worship. Good morning and welcome to First Church, First United Methodist Church here in Lenore. We're glad you're here in person and online. If you're visiting with us, we'd like for you to know that our mission is to glorify God as we mold disciples, nurture them or grow them up, and serve as disciples out in the world. And we do that every week. And that follows even into the summer. We had the neatest vacation Bible school week before last. This week we continued our food gathering for Yoke Fellow, and we're up to 800 pounds. We'll no doubt go over a ton this week. Just think of that, a ton of food. I'm going to contribute 50 more pounds, and I'd love you to take my challenge and have you join me. Today we continue our series on great women of the Bible. It's been exciting for me. I've preached on women in the Bible, but never as a series. And it's been exciting, and I've just been sensitive to everything, including the Olympics. The ladies we have representing us, so many of them are people of faith. Simone Biles and Suni Lee and others in gymnastics. Katie Ledecky and Tori Husk, and I don't know if you saw the four medley last night, and she held off the Australians, who were our huge rivals. Trinity Rodman, who scored a left-footed goal yesterday to beat Japan and move, I guess, to the semifinals, I believe. And Ja'Kari Richardson and other women runners who are just coming into their own because it's just started being covered. So many of them are women of faith. And that's exciting. Today our topic is a pagan woman by the name of Rahab. And if you haven't learned about her, you will today, because she's the most unlikely heroine. Today we also celebrate Holy Communion. And after the hymns, I'm going to do a children's sermon with the kids up here in the chancel with me talking about Holy Communion. Every person here, regardless of age, membership, or faith, is invited to come and receive the bread and the juice, which symbolizes the body and blood of our Savior and Lord Jesus Christ. And also today is the day for favorite hymns. Thank you for sending in suggestions. You'll see that 8 or 9 of them are in there. There are several others that we haven't been able to get in today, but they'll be in ensuing weeks. So we look forward to that. And I just want to thank our communion stewards and our altar guild who do such a beautiful job preparing us for a morning like this. And the altar guild, especially with the new flowers that we've had adorning God's holy church. And now listen as the word of the Lord is read, beginning with verse 1 in the second chapter of the book of Joshua. Then Joshua sent out 2 spies from the Israelite camp at Acacia Grove. He instructed them, "Scout out the land on the other side of the Jordan River, especially around Jericho." So the 2 men set out and came to the house of a prostitute named Rahab and stayed there that night. But someone told the king of Jericho, "Some Israelites have come here tonight to spy out the land." So the king of Jericho sent orders to Rahab, "Bring out the men who've come into your house, for they have come here to spy out the whole land." Rahab had hidden the 2 men, but she replied, "Yes, the men were here earlier, but I didn't know where they were from. They left the town at dusk as the gates were about to close. I don't know where they went. If you hurry, you can probably catch up with them." Actually, she had taken them up to the roof and hidden them beneath bundles of flax she had laid out. So the king's men went looking for the spies along the road leading to the shallow crossings of the Jordan River. And as soon as the king's men had left, the gate of Jericho was shut. Before the spies went to sleep that night, Rahab went up on the roof to talk to them. "I know the Lord has given you this land," she told them. "We are all afraid of you. Everyone in the land is living in terror, for we have heard how the Lord made a dry path for the through the Red Sea, for you through the Red Sea when you left Egypt. And we know what you did to Sihon and Og, the two Amorite kings east of the Jordan River, whose people you completely destroyed. No wonder our hearts have melted in fear. No one has the courage to fight after hearing such things. For the Lord your God is the supreme God of the heavens above and the earth below. Now swear to me by the Lord that you will be kind to me and my family since I have helped you. Give me some guarantee that when Jericho is conquered, you will let me live along with my father and mother, my brothers and sisters, and all their families. Thus ends the reading of the word of the Lord our God. I'm going to turn this moment over to John Beale, our director of music, but go on and stand as we prepare to sing the hymns in our hymnal.
Good morning. We are going to sing the first and last verse of the hymn you see listed. We're going to start with Holy, Holy, Holy.
Thank you.
seated. And I'd like to invite the children to come forward to be with me around the altar table. So Ryan and Mary Stewart, will you come over on this side? And Madison and Alexa and Liam, will you come on this side? Because I want to share with you some things and talk to you about that. But come on up around here. I want you to be here where you can be here right with me and see everything. Today is Communion Sunday, and it's always a special day for us. And when I was your age, I used to look so forward to doing this because it was just really special, and it still is. And we have some ladies and some men who prepare the table for us. And actually, I remind them that as they are filling up these cups with grape juice and getting out the bread and pouring juice into here, making sure everything's spotless. And I'm going to talk to you about this in a moment, too, it looks like water. I tell them to just think of it as serving in God's house, because it is, and preparing a meal for Jesus. And it's a spiritual thing. When we come up here, and it's different people today, it's Miss Jennifer, we want to make sure that everything is pristine and everything's clean. And so we wash our hands over here, and this is a mixture of rubbing alcohol and a little bit of water just to make it go a little farther. So I work in roses in the garden, and so whenever I wash my hands and you see me wince, there's a scratch from the garden because it's alcohol. You know what it is, but alcohol. And, I actually like to do that because I think it takes the pain out. But anyway, this symbolizes being clean in God's spirit to be able to serve the elements, but it's also a disinfectant, so it takes all the germs off of our hands. So just know that's going to happen. Then we wipe our hands, then I lead us in some words that have been true to the church for centuries. They're almost the same exact words that were spoken earlier in our country and also in England for many, many hundreds of years, almost the same exact words. And then when we talk about what Jesus did for us on the night before the crucifixion, it's called Maundy Thursday, and he had his disciples for a meal, and then after the meal, he told them that he had to go die for them and for all of us, but he wanted them and us to remember, because of communion, because of the elements, what it means. And so I will, when it's time, I will pour this grape juice into this little holder, and I'll try to make sure we're able to hear the grape juice being poured. It just makes it more real to know that it's really there. And to put it in the goblet and just make sure. And then I will take the bread, and usually we make sure it's scored. Oh, goodness. So Pastor Dave can get it broken. I'm glad we had his children's son. Anyway, I'll break that somehow. That's a reason to stay awake, at least that long. And then we will pray over these elements, and this is grape juice. And then when it's time, Miss Jennifer and I will serve each other, and then we'll invite people in our church to come down, and usually they come down this aisle and go back up that aisle, and receive the elements. And it's a very special time. I usually say this bread is Jesus' body, take and eat, or something like that. And then we have a prayer. We close this up and put the white cloth over it, reminding us that it's a sacrament. It's something really, really special. Do you have any questions? Liam, do you have any questions? Thinking about something that you, I hope you'll come up to take communion, because
I'm thinking about your veins. you think about your games.
That's good.
And thank you for being on. Girls, do you have any questions or Ryan? Okay. Well, could we hold hands and we'll have a prayer. Lord, you're such a wonderful God. Thank you for these children. We're all children in your eyes. And thank you for the blessed thing that you did for them and for all of us when Jesus died and said before that we need to remember that happened and to remember it as we eat bread and grape juice for wine. Change our lives today through this sacrament. Go with these children now and remind them of your deep, deep, abounding love for them. It's in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, we can go back to our seats now, or the children who want to can also go to the nursery, and I think that maybe somebody will take you there. Great to have you.
The second half of our scripture today comes to us from Joshua 2, 14 through 24. We offer our own lives as guarantee for your safety, the men agreed. If you don't betray us, we will keep our promise and be kind to you when the Lord gives us the land. Then, since Rahab's house was built into the wall, she led them down by a rope through the window. Escape to the hill country, she told them. Hide there for 3 days from the men searching for you. Then, when they have returned, you can go on your way. Before they left, the men told her, "We will be bound by the oath we have taken only if you follow these instructions. When we come into the land, you must leave this scarlet rope hanging from the window through which you let us down. And all of your family members, your father, mother, brothers, and all of your relatives must be here inside the house. If they go into the street and are killed, it will not be our fault. But if anyone lays a hand on people inside this house, we will accept the responsibility of their death. If you betray us, however, we will not be bound by this oath in any way." "I accept your terms," she replied. And she sent them on their way, leaving the scarlet rope hanging from the window. The spies went up into the hill country and stayed there for 3 days. The men who were chasing them searched everywhere along the road, but they finally returned without success. Then the two spies came down from the hill country, crossed the Jordan River, and reported to Joshua all that had happened to them. "The Lord has given us the whole land," they said, "for all these people in the land are terrified of us." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. God of the heavens and the earth, of before and now and after, take our minds and hearts into your heart, that this story might be transformative. It's in the name of Jesus our Lord that we pray. Amen. Spying's dangerous business. We don't know very much about it because it's secretive, but it's dangerous business. And it's a practice that's been around as long as countries have gone to war. I've always been a 007 fan. I know my dad and at least one of my brothers is on with us this morning. Dad and Barry, do you remember when Dad took us to see From Russia with Love and Dr. No? It was a double feature. Wonderful evening. And I have memories of all of the Bond films with their seemingly impossible to defeat villains, the twisted plots, the double crosses, and of course the shaken, not stirred, classy kind of style. And of course, all the beautiful women who gravitated to him. But most spying isn't flamboyant. Spies seek information that will give them the strategic advantage over their enemy, and they don't want to be found out. The more armies know about the strength, positioning, supply lines, and the enemy's current plans, the more likely they'll be able to come out on top in the upcoming battles. Behind the well-known military campaigns of the Second World War lies a secret history that many of the events we don't know about even today. Both Axis and Allied powers planned covert operations and deception tactics, which sought to confuse the enemy at every opportunity. I was reading of one of these deceptions this week. It was named Operation Mincemeat, and it was conceived by British intelligence. Has anyone ever heard of that? Very good. And especially by Captain Ewan Montagu, who hoped to fool the Italians and Nazis regarding the true target for the Allied invasion of Italy. Montagu had a deceased serviceman's body. Here is the British intelligence Montagu. He had a deceased serviceman's body planted off the coast of Spain by a British submarine. The body had full identification and was filled with secret documents purported to reveal that the Allies would invade Italy through Greece and Sardinia, when the true invasion point all along would actually be Sicily. And the Germans bought the deception hook, line, and sinker. They acted swiftly on the false information, and they doubled the number of troops sent to Sardinia and also transferred many German divisions to Greece and the Balkans because they thought that's where the Allies were going to attack. The Allied invasion of Sicily was launched on July the 9th, 1943, and as intended, proved to be a surprise to the enemy defenders. It took a month, and only that, for the Allies to capture the whole island and be ready then to go into Europe. And the lack of enemy reinforcements proved to be a deciding factor in Operation Mincemeat's success. In warfare, good inside information and disinformation greatly help the cause of the side that's better at it. And that's the underlying theme and principle of the second chapter of the book of Joshua. The whole chapter reads like a spy novel that has us, or at least me, sitting on the edge of our seats throughout the whole story. It's a well-known and also a much-loved story of an insider who gives information and protection to outsiders, and as a result, gains important historical significance in God's plan for the redemption of humankind. Rahab's story provides us with a host of types and symbols that we shouldn't ignore. Now, it's easy to get bogged down in the details, expounding on how inept the spies were, and in the Bible they usually are, or entangled in arguments with the morality of Rahab's lying to her king to gain advantage. But today we'll approach this story from a little different perspective, one that illustrates how Rahab's life is a shadow of the movement of God in the lives of unbelievers. And it all begins with God's grace. Here's the setting. Joshua's getting ready to lead the people of Israel across the Jordan and to start the conquest of the land, a conquest they've hoped to begin for the last 40 years, a time they've been wandering around in the wilderness. God had called Moses to help his people and to lead them. But Moses' patience ran out with the Israelites when they chose to worship a golden calf over the Lord their God. And that story is kind of a funny story too. When Aaron was asked what happened, he said, well, we threw this gold in there and out came this calf. And, you know, That's not exactly how it would have happened. Moses had prepared the Israelites for the conquest, but because of his several mistakes, he wasn't allowed by God to enter the promised land with the people he had led. Joshua was tasked with that responsibility. Now, interestingly, we need to know before the story starts that every people group the Israelites are going to encounter with the vision of conquering them is to be considered harem, H-E-R-E-M, or devoted to God. But it wasn't really meaning devoted to God. What it means is that they were to be God's pawns. The Israelites were commanded to send them to him, which in Bible talk is in essence to defeat them one and all, really wiping them all out. But before the Israelites can cross over the river and begin their conquest, Joshua decides to do what any good general would do. Find out as much as he can. Do all he can to get the lay of the land. A lot of things had changed in 40 years since Joshua had last been there. And it only made good sense, he thought, for him to send spies out for greater intelligence as they began their campaign. Now, some might have said that this shows a lack of faith on Joshua's part because he had already been promised success by God. But nowhere in the Bible, interestingly, is Joshua ever faulted for doing this, and actually it could be argued easily that this action directly led to the inclusion of Rahab into the family of God, which of course it did. The ancestry of Jesus himself, Rahab, becomes a part of that. And the addition of her name to the hall of faith, as is recorded in Hebrews 11, read that later today. This former prostitute became a child of God and is listed in the hall of faith. No, Joshua did exactly what God wanted him to do. Because just as the grace of God used a famine, even a famine, to send Elimelech, Naomi, and their sons to Moab to meet up with the Moabite woman by the name of Ruth, God's grace would also bless the sending of spies into the city of Jericho to meet and start the process of rehab of a prostitute named Rahab. And folks, Rahab had everything going against her. Her life was going to be forfeited with everyone else's because the Jews were coming in and everyone who wasn't a child of God was destined to immediate death. Two, she was a woman. And Middle Eastern society regarded women as having less worth than men. And then Rahab practiced an occupation that was severely frowned upon in Hebrew society. Rahab had nothing going for her except the grace of God, which was demonstrated when in Joshua it's recorded, the spies went and came into the house of a prostitute whose name was Rahab and lodged there. It's a wonderful example of God's grace coming upon one of the least of these that Jesus talks about in Matthew 25. God's grace came to Rahab and saved her whole household, bringing faithful Gentiles like you and me into the people of God. It's what many years ago the disciple and apostle Peter's preaching dealt with, when many more people, Gentiles from the outside, non-Jews, were brought into the fellowship of the family of God. Praise God for his abundant and unexpected grace that too brings you and me to faith in Christ and into a changed life. But remember how Rahab spoke of her understanding of Almighty God's presence and power. To the spies, she says, I know that the Lord has given you this land, and that the terror of you has fallen on us, and that all of the inhabitants of the land have melted away before you in fear. For we have heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea before you when you came out of Egypt. And two, we have all heard of what you did to the two kings of the Amorites who were beyond the Jordan Sion and Og, whom you utterly destroyed. When we heard it, she said, our hearts melted, and no courage remained in any man any longer because of you. For the Lord your God, he is God in heaven above and earth beneath. Wow. Can you imagine as a person the scripture labels as a foreigner, a pagan, a prostitute, sharing such words of awareness of the presence of the one true God? Awareness that's later also detailed in the book of James in the New Testament. You see that a man is justified by works and not by faith alone, James writes. In the same way, was not Rahab the prostitute also justified by works when she received the messengers of God and sent them out another way? In Romans, Paul tells us, faith comes from hearing, and hearing comes from the word of Christ. But hold it. What kind of God is this, who allows all kinds of people into his kingdom? Handicapped, strong, paupers, prostitutes? And not only that, but what kind of a God would raise them up among his people and use them to preserve that kingdom and his people? This is an amazing God, a God like no other. A God cares for all of his people and seeks to bring all with a capital A into his family. Think about that. Even a foreign, pagan, immoral, prostitute. What an amazing God we have. A God open to all. Rahab's faith came through hearing about the great things that God had done. She started out by confessing that she knows that God has already given the Israelites the land of her people, which is where she was still living, land that wouldn't be hers and theirs much longer. And that's a remarkable confession, because a single battle hadn't even been fought in the promised land, Canaan, yet. The only way she could have known this kind of thing and had this kind of knowledge is through her faith in God, the God of Israel. And that faith came through hearing the reports of God's work among his people, long before they even got to her land. The Red Sea and the destruction of the Egyptian army had happened many years earlier. But apparently the people of Canaan, the promised land, and especially those living around Jericho, still remembered it and talked about it. And then more recently, the destruction of the two pagan kings, Sion and Og, on the other side of the Jordan, let everyone know of this God and his strength, and that he was still both with his people and even still fighting for them. Once again, we remember that faith comes by hearing, and hearing from the word of God. That's what we see all across the Bible. Calls to people of faith to openly brag about the wonders of God. Psalm 96 is a great example. Tell of his glory among all the nations, his wonderful deeds among all the peoples. Is that something you do regularly? With you, I'm guilty of not speaking of the wonders of our God often enough. But why is that? Do we no longer believe in the God of wonders? The Israelites were chosen by God to be a special people, people who were tasked with spreading his glory throughout the world. Speaking through the prophet Isaiah, God told them, I will make you a light to all the nations, so that my salvation will reach to the end of the earth. Rahab had heard, and she believed. And that belief brought about a change in her life. Just like when Jacob wrestled with the Lord at the river Jabbok, and the Lord touched him in the thigh. Remember that story? And popped his leg out of socket, and it remained that way for the rest of his life. Jacob's life was changed, and so was his walk. When Rahab came to faith in the Lord, those were the changes that came over her too. Though she was still both a stranger and an alien to Israelites, she still risked her life and livelihood to not only save the two Hebrew spies, but also to help them escape with the vital information that fear had gripped the hearts of the people across the Jordan. Fear had gripped the people of Jericho. Rahab actually committed treason against her own people and her own king when she turned away and repented of her former life and identified herself with the people of God. And once again, isn't that exactly what happens when people come to faith in Christ? Isn't that actually what happened to you when you knew you were God's? We turn away from otherworldly dreams and become new creatures with a totally new heart and a new country, one in which all of our former allegiances are nullified. And in so doing, we too become citizens of an entirely different kingdom. And Rahab's faith would be rewarded. So the men said to her, the Bible records, "Our life for yours, if you do not tell this business of ours. And it shall come about when the Lord gives us the land that we will deal kindly and faithfully with you." And again, she cited in the New Testament, which reads, "But by faith, Rahab the prostitute did not perish along with those who were disobedient after she had welcomed God's spies in peace." You know, it's only natural that when someone comes to faith, he or she wants their loved ones to come along with them. But the truth is that this is a decision that every person must make on his or her own. Amazingly, Rahab already knew of the Almighty God. Amazingly, she wanted her whole family to know him too. God had led the Israelites to the promised land, and God's chosen Joshua was going to finally lead them into it after 40 years. Joshua wanted to know as much as he could about what kind of resistance they might expect, but the bottom line was that the armies of God were going to conquer the city of Jericho, and very few people who lived under Jericho's king's rule would survive. People who know God are not satisfied when it's only they who are aware. We want our friends, we want our families to know the experience of faith that we have experienced. Rahab did too. She wanted all of her family, all pagans, to be saved from the judgment that was about to fall upon Jericho and all the land of Canaan. She wanted them, too, to be taken into the commonwealth of Israel, right along with her. So a deal was struck, and her family would be saved, but only certain conditions. The scripture reads, "Before they left, the men told her, 'We will be bound by the oath we have taken only if you follow these instructions. When we come into the land, you must leave this scarlet rope,'" there's a picture of it on your bulletins, "'hanging from the window through which you let us down. And all of your family members, your father, your mother, brothers, and all your relatives must be here inside this house with you. If they go out on the street and are killed, it will not be our fault. But if anyone is to lay a hand on people inside this house, we will bear the responsibility for their death. If you betray us, however, we are not bound by this oath in any way." 40 years earlier, the Jews in Egypt were saved from the angel of death by the blood of the lamb on the doorposts of their houses. You remember it from the book of Exodus. When the angel of death came by that house on the first Passover, the angel would see the mark of blood and pass on by, and everyone inside would be saved. So Rahab took a scarlet cord, probably a length of thick rope of some kind, because the thread would have been too tiny, too fine to even notice in the heat of battle. And when the spies thought about that red cord, it would have immediately reminded them of Egypt and Passover. So in similar fashion that their own parents were saved from destruction, now Rahab and her family would be saved too, but only so long as they stayed under the protection of that red cord. Can you see the similarity to my salvation and yours here? Again, in Romans, Paul writes, God showed his great love for us by sending Christ to die for us while we were all yet sinners. And since we have been made right in God's sight by the blood of Christ, he will certainly save us from God's condemnation. How appropriate it is that momentarily you and I will move into the service of Holy Communion, remembering the life of Jesus Christ, who is our Passover Lamb, who takes away the sins of the entire world, who has been sacrificed, his own blood being shed, so that trusting in him, we all may live abundantly today and forever. What an amazing, wonderful God this is. Let us pray. Thank you, O God, for receiving us all, even with our brokenness, Lord, even with our frailties. Receive us again, O God, and with our scarlet Lord Jesus Christ, redeem us from death to life. It's in his holy name that we pray. Amen. And now I ask that you prepare your hearts. You will not need to turn in your hymnals for the worship this morning for the sacrament, but prepare your hearts and minds as we prepare the elements of Holy Communion.
Lift up your hearts and give thanks to God. Blessed are you, O God, who with your word and Holy Spirit created all things and called them good. In Jesus Christ, your word became flesh and dwelt among us. Through Jesus' suffering and death, you took upon yourself our sin and death and destroyed their power forever. You raised from the dead the same Jesus, who now reigns with you in glory, and poured upon us your Holy Spirit, making us the people of your new covenant. On the night before meeting with death, Jesus took bread, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, Jesus took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts, that in the breaking of this bread and the drinking of this wine we may know the presence of the living Christ and be renewed as the body of Christ for the whole world, redeemed by Christ's blood, until Christ comes again in final victory and we feast at your heavenly banquet forever. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty God, now and forever. And now, as children of God, let us pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you. Let's pray. Lord, transform our very lives and those in our families and friends through the imparting of the life of your Son, Jesus, to save us from our sins and to draw us nearer and nearer to you. It's in his name that we pray. Amen. And now let's pray over our offering. There are plates at the door. If you're visiting with us, we ask that you not contribute, but we will, as God's family here at First Church. Let us pray. Loving God, for all your blessings, we are thankful. Bless these gifts that your people return to you, that these resources might be used to bring people far from you much, much, much closer. It's in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen. And now please stand, John.
Our first hymn in this section is Here I Am, Lord, number 593, first and last verse.
I have heard my people cry.
give us Hymn of Promise 707. Just first one to pass it on. Just first one.